It's time to reboot, realign, and just redo your 2020.
I like that actually. That's very good. Now I'm excited. That's awesome. And we're going to talk about flying during COVID-19 today on a very modified Wandering Zen.
Welcome to Wandering But Not Lost, your online source for finding balance so that you can align, connect, and prosper.
I'm living right here and now, and I don't want to miss out. Is this what life's all about? The world is calling, and I'm listening. Yeah, I'm listening.
And now, your hosts, Jen O'Brien and Matt Emerson.
You've reached the Wandering But Not Lost podcast. It's episode 122, where real estate and reality meet. You can find all of our show notes over at WBNLpodcast.com. Jen O'Brien.
How's it going in Florida, Matt Emerson?
It is going hot and sticky and muggy, summertime in the Sunshine State.
Don't be talking bad about my future home state now.
I'm not talking bad about it. I'm just stating the facts. It's hot and muggy and it rains every day, which I love the rain, actually. It's awesome. We had a thunderstorm a couple days ago that went on for hours, and I love them. Now, I suppose they might become tiresome if you're in it a lot, but I think they're awesome. So, it's so almost hail. And the wind is crazy. It just kind of whips in and flows on out. Kind of wild. So anyway, so doing that.
And I, how was the flight there? So I've had some family members fly and have, a decent experience because it wasn't crowded yet, for them anyway. They had a bad flight going home. They flew from West Coast to East Coast to Atlanta, and it was a horrendous flight, but it was really not that many, like 50 people on the plane. And then coming back, they felt it was a lot better as well, but very, very still deserted in the, comparatively speaking, in the airports.
Well, I didn't really find that to be completely true. I flew out on a red eye out of LAX to come down here because I had to make a quick reservation, and that was the only one I could get, which actually worked out perfectly because I could sleep on the plane with my mask because I am still not used to masks. So when I go to a store, and I'll be there for 20 minutes, I can handle that. But to wear it for a day is a very weird thing.
I agree. It is hard to adapt.
It's bizarre. But LAX that night for that red eye, it was the last flight out that night, I think, out of that terminal for Delta. And it was completely, there was only, our gate was the only gate that really had any people in it. So the airport was pretty empty.
Wow.
TSA was, really easy because there just weren't that many people there. But I can tell you, every single person in there wearing a mask, TSA was actually super efficient. You could see where they had put the social distancing marks in the queue as you line up in the, in the queue to get into to TSA. So, even if it was crowded, it would be very efficient. And, the line could go on forever because you're 6 feet apart. And you really are 6 feet apart where those lines are. You have to take your mask off when you go to actually show your license, right? Obviously. I have a newer mask that actually ties. It doesn't just flip around the ears. A little bit inconvenient because you had to untie it, take it off, and untie it, put it back on. But whatever. I mean, you know what I mean? That was all it was. Super, no problem there. On the plane, they were real sticklers about those masks. You had to wear them all the time. There wasn't like get on the plane and just it's footloose and fancy for you. That's not the way it was. Now, the flight that I had was completely booked in the new guidelines. So no center seats, but every other seat on the plane, and it was a 757, it's a big plane, was booked. So there were, it was, I mean, that's, it's, it was a full flight in today by today's standards. So, which is a little bit, it's just kind of odd. Awesome, there's no one sitting next to you. That is a really
good. What if you were traveling with somebody, could you sit next to them? Is that
no.
part of
No, I mean, well, I suppose you could move over if you wanted to. You had that kind of scenario going on, so you could sit next to them if you want to. But you would have to purchase those, the seats separately, with that seat in between. So interesting the way that all worked out. But it was cool, the in-flight services were pretty much just they gave you a baggie, a zip tie baggie that was closed. It had a bottle of water in it. It had one of the flights had Cheez-Its, like a little cookie. And Purell. It was like, okay, here's our little kit.
No service. Did
other
they do
than that? That was it. Nothing.
No alcohol else. Service.
No, nothing else. So that was it. So, I was. I can't say that I. Well, during the red eye, I slept anyway. But I would have missed my little glass of pop of wine on the plane. So anyway, that wasn't there. Got to Atlanta, and the airport was very busy. I don't want to say it was as busy as I've ever seen it, because it wasn't like that, but it was busier than I thought it was going to be. And the mask usage in Atlanta was maybe 50%. It was weird. Now, I know for a fact that when these people got on the plane, they were going to have to put them on, or at least for Delta, and I think all of the airlines are doing that, to do their flying. So that was a little bit unnerving, because it's like, I just came from total masks for all these hours into this area where it's like, I guess they don't, you know.
Choose to if you want to. And that's what I'm, aren't you finding that out and about? It's like it's recommended, but there's half the people do, half the people don't.
Yeah, right? Completely. So that was interesting. And then the second flight, actually, I got bumped to first class, which was actually very nice because I was bumped to first class and there was no one next to me. So it was even better than normal. But even there, it was the baggie of water and Cheez-Its and Purell. The Purell is my favorite part. So you could wash your, wipe your do your hands at the
very end. Is it like an individual amount?
Yeah, it was like a little... Yeah, it was like a one usage type of thing.
Like a packet.
Yeah, and it wasn't a wipe. It was actually liquid in there, but it was, anyway, it's just odd, right? Now, the pilot did say, and I thought it was really interesting, he said as we got on the plane that they have, their sanitizing methods and their HEPA air filters on that plane. He said the air that you're breathing in this plane, it's probably cleaner air than you're breathing anywhere. And he said, I'm not just saying that because I'm a pilot for Delta. I'm saying that because it's the truth. So he goes, don't sit here, during your flight and worry about the air quality on the airline. Everything is good.
The masks are protect you from other people that are maybe sick or don't know they're sick or maybe care.
For you spewing on other people, right? Interesting. There were no babies on this flight. There were no dogs on this flight already. I'm like, woohoo. And there was not one person on there sniffing and coughing and doing all that stuff because, you don't want to be that guy. So it was a very quiet, interesting flight. You know what I mean? I got to say, I think when things get back to normal, I'm going to miss parts of this, the flying experience. So,
well, this is the question, what is going to be what's new? Because we're never going back to the way that things were, in my opinion. And that's what I think people are having a hard time sort of adjusting to. Getting to wear down on everybody, don't you think?
Totally.
And this is why there's still so much chaos and just everything that's gone on in the last week or so with the protests and people in mass groups. And
right.
It's almost like we went from, there's no virus to now that you start hearing about outbreaks again. And so I just don't know how much more we can all take.
Big upticks here in Florida over the last week and a half. So it's interesting. I talked to one of the stewardesses, or excuse me, flight attendants.
Yes, there you go.
And just asking how it's been for her. And she said, we were really very nervous about the whole thing at first. But it's all kind of worked out okay, at least for the with me and the people that I have worked with. And she goes, by instituting the everyone wears a mask policy, it made us feel a lot better because it didn't feel like we were walking around with masks on, but still very exposed to all of these people. Not that you are completely safe, but it does heighten the security, the protection.
Sure.
So they were saying that really overall they feel pretty good about it, and they have a job, so there's that too. So I have to say, overall, I didn't know what to expect on this flight. I had a pretty good idea of what things were going to be like, but everyone was very polite. And not that it's not always like that, but you do run into crankiness when people are flying, because there's a lot of stress involved with the whole flying, process. But overall, it was really very good. I think really to really kind of think about the whole experience since I left, 3 weeks ago, everywhere I've gone and everything, anyone I've come into contact with and have talked to has been overly sensitive to the situation.
Right.
That's just the people I have been around. And I think I've been around a lot of doctors this week because I've been going to some appointments with a family member, and it has it's been very organized, and I think people are doing the best they can do. And I applaud everybody for that. It's really awesome.
I agree with that, because have you gone into any restaurants, or has there been some changes to that, or still not?
Haven't been to any restaurants.
I have to a few, and it's interesting people's take on what social distancing's like. So you've got some people who are very much about their 6 feet of distance and you feel sort of comfortable, but it is weird to go into a restaurant or a place like that, and all the staff's wearing masks, but just about everybody is not.
Well, because how are you going to eat? You can't eat with one. So, it is an odd thing. And it's like, do you just take it off when you're eating?
I don't know. Yeah. And when you're wandering around, do you do it? So this is all part of what we have to adjust to. And I feel like it's the, what we're going to do for a while. And I think it's, it, you know, so we're all adapting. And that's what we're going to jump into. Let's dive into a little bit about what we've talked about already on the podcast, direct you back, and kind of where maybe we, a lot of us are where we all are today. And we want to talk to you about some exciting stuff that we're doing with we've been empowered and I guess, I don't know what's inspired, I guess is the word, to reboot and relaunch our company, our training coaching company. So we have a few things to tell you about that later too. And we're going to unveil a very affordable group coaching program that is going to help carry on and get everybody where they need to be in their business with a new focus. And next week, by the way, I went to the Inman Connect conference, and I'm going to talk about the takeaways from that that are right in alignment with everything that we've been doing so far. Very excited to share.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that.
Around the country, from brokers to industry leaders to other agents. It was a cool experience. It was all online. It was very affordable. And they're changing the way they're doing things, and I frankly liked it a lot. I missed the HooliCon part, Matt, which is the being able to, even though they tried to have, you know, virtual meetups and coffees and happy hours, it's not the same of physically meeting people and networking with them.
Right.
However, I liked a lot about it, and I'll talk about it next week. So let's dive in and talk about your 2020 reboot.
You're listening to the Wandering But Not Lost podcast, where real estate and reality meet. Join us and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google Play, and now on YouTube.
Yes, this is episode 122 of the Wandering But Not Lost podcast. Definitely have some notes, show notes for you over at episode 122, wbnlpodcast.com. So as I mentioned at the top of the show, and I just wanted to point out, episode 18, we talked about manifesting your new normal. And in that, we talked about just having this ability to adapt and embracing change and pivoting to all these new things that were happening. And so we've had some time now to do that. So I'm going to revisit a little of that, but I'm not going to cover all those. If you want to go and listen to that, that's 18. And then back in episode, not 18, 118, that wasn't that far back. Episode 120, we just talked about Virtual Agent Toolkit, where we talked a little bit about what are the new tech things that you've really got to be able to embrace if you haven't already been doing it. But today I want to talk about how with just, personally, what I'm going through, what we're going through is in a company is I've made this decision to get back into coaching and building my team 100% as opposed to being more involved in running the company. I'm very excited about our decision to reboot our company, and more on that in a little bit. So what you're going to hear from me in the coming weeks is stuff I'm actually doing and coaching people to do. I'm actually walking my own talk. And I don't have to think about what I need to do. I have to go, Jan, just do the things you tell people you work with. And I get it. It's hard to balance the whole working on your business while you're working in the business.
That's right. Boots on the ground.
Boots on the ground, but we're making it happen. And I'm very excited because as I work on systems and we work with our friend David Squire, who's going to be part of our company, and the energy of David and Matt and I, who have known each other for, gosh, 6 years or so. I've known David for 18 plus years, but the three of us have worked together and known each other.
Jim McGraw, we met in 2012, so you can do the math on that.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Eight years?
Who would have thought?
Oh my God, I was thinking it was like 5-6 years ago. What are we saying? We're coming up on like the 6th anniversary. Or the,
eight.
What's the anniversary of WBNL coaching?
Five. It'll be 5 years in November.
5 years. All right. Well, we're excited about all the things that we're doing.
Time flies when you're having fun.
And I am so jazzed to launch this group coaching program that we're going to do. We think we're going to launch it in the beginning of July, maybe right after the holiday, because we've got to get a few things lined up for you. But we'll be sending more information out to you. You got to make sure you get on our mailing list if you're not already, whether you subscribe to the podcast or you just want to reach out to myself. Just Google me, right? Janet Jan O'Brien, and I'll be happy to talk to you about it a little bit more. But I wanted to talk about the very first thing I did. Is I looked at, because June 1st is when I was making this transition to 100%, you know, coaching and building my team and focusing on our company, our coaching company. And I just decided that why don't we just do a redo for 2020, right? So when you go back historically and just look at the housing numbers, everybody across the country was off to an amazing year. The first quarter of 2020 was was just for our company, for everything. It was just really showing how awesome everything was. Yep. Now, even though things adjusted, if the pandemic had never happened, there was going to be there's no doubt, because they already just said, you know, February started a dip to a bit of a recession. And a re-correction, if you will, of the stock market and the housing market. And that was just going to happen anyway.
Sure.
I think a theme that has emerged, this theme came out of Inman quite a bit, and I'll talk about it next week, is acceleration. Accelerate. Honestly, that might be an awesome name for our group thing. Accelerate. Just came up with that. I'm writing it down right now. That is the theme of what everyone was talking about, is that the virus, the COVID-19, has accelerated things that were already moving in a certain direction. Everything. I mean, you could even apply that theory, that theme, to what's happening culturally in our country.
Sure.
With the protests and the movements and the direction, and just sort of this chaos has sort of created, you know, just... I don't know. This, like, you have to kind of go through that till you get to the other side, right?
It was an election year anyway, so there was already going to be, you know what I mean? So it is,
Everything is accelerated. It's like the fuel that was put on the fire to just, to have everything do. You and I talked about this whole thing being a universe, the Earth rebooting itself, right? Like a whole reset, whatever you want to call it. So June 1 for me was, let me just focus on June to December. Don't worry and commiserate over, oh, it was so good the first quarter, then, oh my God, the second quarter, we had to deal with all this. Our lives have changed. They have. And we've already talked a ton about adapting. And I'm so excited to see the people that we've interacted with, or people that were in our 30-day challenge, make the adjustments, and they're killing it in their businesses. And here's what I see happening out there on the positive side. Because I choose to focus on that. Doesn't mean that there's days where I'm like, what the heck? This is like a lot to deal with. But then I just move my energy to, where are the opportunities? And I see it. So people talk about all these people who are unemployed. I'm like, there are opportunities to go do something else.
Right.
Or adjust their jobs. There are 10, 15 companies, major companies, that are hiring tens of thousands of people because of the adjustments to the way we do the world, the way we live now. So and that's the way real estate is changing. So there's just three things that I want to talk about, just as a reminder, that are the three key things to do to sit down right now and reboot. It's a do-over. It's a realignment of your 2020, so you can set yourself up for 2021. And you can make it through anything that happens, even if we have another outbreak. I don't know if we're ever going to get to this way we were so strict shutting down. Who knows? But if we all just sort of work together, and this is the hard part, because not everybody has the same mindset about everything, right?
That's right.
That if we all figure, you know, the statistics and the stats are going to keep showing that if we just do things a little bit differently, we'll all get through this together. And it will be painful if we don't in certain places. So it's going to be different in different parts of the country and et cetera. So I personally feel everyone is making a decision right now. Like, we've opened up Nevada. They've opened up the casinos. I drive around and I'm saying, I don't see tons of people there. I would say that the surveys are right. There's 50, 60% of the people are saying, yeah, I'm going to wait.
Yep.
I'm going to hang on there.
You know, theme parks have just opened back up too. Or they're starting to. Universal Orlando here just opened up on the 1st. And same type of deal. I've been watching the app, because I have the app on my phone because I love that theme park. And I've been watching the queues, the wait times.
What's it like?
5 minutes, 5 minutes, 5 minutes, because it's not busy. People are just, I don't know. I don't know if the experience of wanting to go to a theme park and wear a mask all day long and stay social distance and not would be a very different experience.
I
think people are waiting. You know, Disney's opening up here, I think on the very quickly. And then in Disneyland just said they were going to open up on the 17th, which is Disneyland's 65th birthday. So they're opening up on the 17th of July. So, you know, and I think it's going to be, you know, Disneyland will be busy when it first opens, but I think really here's the deal. They're also having, you know, a lower number of people they allow in. So it's going to be less crowded anyway. But I think you're absolutely right. Getting to your point that people are, you know, there are some people that are like, I'm out, I'm in, let's just do it. But there are a lot of people that are going to be a little bit more hesitant for whatever reason.
Absolutely. And I basically say, you know, do what you feel comfortable with, but maybe you come from a place of, be smart, be safe, and let's all
Absolutely.
get through it. So we're not, it's not like going to happen overnight is the point. I feel like we are in this new reality and into the next year, and who knows whatever, you know, that's the problem. I think everybody gets stressed out over, I think the anxiety is off the charts because the people that are focused on what is going to happen, and we do not know. So all we can do is focus on right now, today. So that's number one, do a mindset check. Focus on today, now. Don't commiserate and worry about what we don't even know. Like what's the word I'm looking for? It's not useful. It's wasted energy to sit around all day. And so the very first thing here is regulate how much time you're spending watching the news. The news media outlets, social media, whatever your flavor, they're designed to sell advertising and to report the most, you know, craziest stuff so that we'll watch it, right? So I'm not saying you can't be aware of what's going on, but man, if you spend all your time consuming all that, it's not like it's an upbeat positive message anywhere, right? And you just find yourself drugged down into that. So I have adapted a thing where I just might check in occasionally, but I used to watch it daily all the time, like probably you, right?
Oh yeah.
And Laura and all that. And now, how about now? You've been away for a little bit.
Three weeks. There are many days I don't even turn. No, zero is what I've turned it down to. I mean, literally, I think in the last 3 weeks, probably a total of an hour. You know, so I'm aware of what's happening in the world because it's important to know what's going on. But there is no need to watch countless endless hours of the same old thing. There's no need. And I don't know that I'll ever go back to it because my life is that little part. You just don't need it.
I agree. So, and this will help you stay put some, so if you're going to replace that with something, then it's when you're, you know, find the things that make you happy. So what I still believe in a morning routine, I've stayed on with my meditations. I'm not getting out and doing the walking that I want to do. It's kind of hot here, but it's not an excuse. I should get out there and do it. But whatever, I find something that helps me start the day off right. And it's certain meditations. I enrolled in something from tut.com. It's a 21-day visualization project. I have a link to the in the show notes. Just go to TUT. And it's basically, I've followed Mike Dooley's stuff for years. He was in The Secret and from years ago. And I always get his daily notes from the universe. It's a great positive thing to have come to your inbox every day. And it's just a message from the universe. I actually put the one in there today. The one I got today was report card day, and it was perfect. A lot of times the message that comes is perfectly what you need. And this just might be something like this that helps you, whether you pick up a book and open it up and it's an affirmation, it's something, it helps you refocus how you're gonna feel today and then move on and work on the things that you need to do. But the one that was today was like, here's what it says, report card day. Jan, here's your report card from the School of Life. Compassionate, A+. Gives of self even when no one's looking. Intuitive, A+. Ability to see from others' perspective, and it goes on, A+. You know, terminally optimistic, fast rebounder, A+. Exercises gratitude muscle, A+. Good looking, A+. I like that one. A real body, it said. Patient and kind to self, could play a little more. And I thought, oh, that was interesting. That was like a message for me to say, stop being so serious, right? And then performs random acts of faith in line with dreams. And it just goes on to say, so it's always got your name in it. You ace the very toughest courses in time and space. Now, since the last two subjects are the easiest, you get to grade yourself, which is about taking care of yourself, visualizing success every day. And, you know, so it's super powerful. I got that today. I had to share it. And it just got me realizing that start your day off with something that fires you up. What is it that gets you in the right space? How do you find that balance in your life? There's no excuse not to go out and walk, or if you're an evening person that does all that. You've been doing some walking since you've been there?
It's too hot.
Even in the early morning?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was like, I'm not kidding you when I tell you this. It was 85 at 8:30.
All right. What about listening to your podcast? I got to help Matt out here, everybody.
No, I'm fine. I have been doing stuff like that. And actually, we've been working a lot of puzzles too, which, you know what? Sounds silly. They're very cathartic and fun.
Well, they are. And it gets you to stop thinking about other stuff. So there you go. Well done. Puzzle. I don't have the patience for that. All right. So check your mindset. Number two, I'm going to keep saying this. We are not in a housing crisis. The housing market, I don't think anytime soon. I watch all these statistics. I recommend highly getting keepingcurrentmatters.com. I am so on top of what's happening. And thanks to David Squire, we get the weekly stats report. I really understand our market. And even in the worst of the downturn here for the shutdown, we are rebounding quickly. And nationally, it's real estate's local, but the national trends are positive. So today in the show notes, if you go over and look at it, everybody that's anybody that tracks any of this, economists, housing experts, from everybody from Zillow to economists to CNBC, and everyone is like inspired by how quickly the housing market is rebounding. So all these things right in the middle of COVID, the deep shutdown part was housing's going to help. We think it's going to help. Everything is up right now. And I just got the report for May. And it's the numbers for May, so it just came out in June. And I think the numbers for June are even going to be better, which will come out in July. Yeah. The bottom line is the opportunities in the housing market right now is there's generally low inventory everywhere. So here it is in a nutshell. Since there's low inventory, and it's worse, and I coach some people in Florida right now, and they got no inventory.
Right.
Here in Vegas, there's still inventory, there's still opportunities, but it's still a seller's market. Some parts of the country, it's definitely a seller's market. Not a lot for buyers to choose from, and they have to be really ready to make an offer and maybe even pay a little more. So that's the point. That's keeping the housing prices steady, if not increasing. So projections right now from all the top experts are saying 3-5% appreciation still, even with COVID-19, because of inventory, all right? So that's positive. So you know what the big focus needs to be for everybody? Go get more listings. Listings. So I've got stats in here to show you the graphs on the projections, even for the rest of this year. You know, anywhere from a modest gain, Fannie Mae is saying 0.4%. So is Freddie, same thing, up to 3.8 from others around the country in appreciation for 2020. And then you'll see it for 2021 and some projections for 2022. Here's some other good news. Month over month, national pending sales were up 24.5% from April. April was the bottom, if you will, the trough that they're saying, already up 25% month over month, and new listings taken up 20% across the nation. Okay, so and the other big news that came out of this national report was new home sales rose slightly in April, defying expectations of a huge 22% drop. So the experts were saying new homes were going to drop 22% and they were up slightly. So what does that mean? Real estate professionals, go sell some new homes and focus on listings. That's what I'm doing. That's what our team is doing. All right. Last point, adjust your 2020 business plan. We talked briefly about this in our first our episode when we were talking 118. So here's where I mean. If you haven't already done it, because I've done it, we're doing it right now for WBNL coaching. We're redoing our business plan and our goals for the rest of this year, and then start to think about what goals might be for 2021. So all I'm saying is just realign. Even if you didn't do a business plan, who cares? Do one now. It's your 6 month. What am I going to do from now to December? How many transactions do I want? How much money? However you want to do it, keep it simple. You know, we've adapted a principle here that less is more, all right? We are going to continue to deliver things that are efficient, simple, that are the key things you need to do to run your business smoothly by leveraging technology, but not forgetting that it's about your clients and your relationships first. In fact, that is the theme for everything I'm doing as a team, as I'm working with coaching. It's what came out of the Inman Connect. It's relationships plus the right technology, understanding what your consumer wants, leveraging tech so you're more efficient and you can deliver the experience the consumer wants equals success. So everything we do at WBNL Coaching is going to have that focus. Our coaching programs, our group coaching, and all of the training that we're revamping. We're so excited to Matt is down in Florida. He's been working night and day trying to get all that stuff launched onto a new beautiful platform. We're super excited about all that. So finishing up on your goals and your plan, what have you adapted to in your business to leverage the things I just talked about? Are you good with using video and video conferencing? And what tech tools, what CRM are you choosing to use? What are the 4 or 5 tools that you've got to stick with? It's not about more. It's about convenience and also efficiency with the right tools that work for you. Now, that might vary based on what your company provides. And if you're in a company where you don't have all that, we know what those tools are. Have you made those adjustments for your how you make your connections in your marketing? I think it's super important right now that the messaging has to be different to the consumer to say, we're here, we listen, consumer, we've adapted to the new world order here. We're COVID-19, you know, here's how we all work. It's all good. You got to have that messaging in everything that you do. And we have some great things to share with you on that. I think you have to ultimately refresh all that marketing and go back and give everything a reboot around what has happened and how you've adjusted and how you're successful with it. And talk to the consumer. It's not about us. It's about them. And you know how you have adjusted your business to support that.
Which, by the way, everyone should be doing this, no matter if it was COVID or not, because right, it's time to always look at your plan to see where you stand and then make adjustments. So
it was already trending. It wasn't like when you think of, I'll end on this comment. And I just think it's so powerful about this acceleration. I listened to Gary Keller and others, and there was the same theme, and I'll get into the details of that next week. But this acceleration thing was, if you think about it, the consumer has been in charge for a long time now, right? How long has it been since they had access to all the details for listings, just sticking in our industry? Platforms, companies are emerging from Compass and others that are all about tech. And even KW is you know, revamping everything they're doing so that it delivers what the consumer wants. So that was already happening. And a statement Keller made was, I feel that we were on track for all of this anyway. When you think, and he was mentioning he and others were mentioning, and we've been tracking this too. It's an on-demand economy now. Think about how we wanted to get food delivered to us, or Amazon, or you think about any of these industries. All that's happened now is things have went even more to that way. It's swung more. That's why some of these jobs are gone now. But now the people that are hiring are Amazon, Uber Eats, Grubhub, all these places that need help because of the way the consumer has changed the way they do business. And that's the same way with real estate. So all this has done is accelerate a path that might have taken 10 years to get to. And I think what's happening is because of this, the smart people, the people who are forward thinking, are going to figure out how to adapt and be the next Zoom. Like Zoom, you know, killed it. Zoom had it, was out there, and everybody adapted to it, but there'll always be somebody coming along to say, how do we make a better platform? How do we make a better experience for the consumer? So anyway, that's the stuff that you've got to stay on top of. And then if you see it and you pivot and you get to the direction that where the consumer wants and you stay on top of it, you're fine. You'll just keep adjusting to whatever is happening. And I, for one, am excited about those opportunities. And if you don't get that, then maybe real estate's not for you, and it's okay. You know, because the ones who do get it are going to do well, and they're going to probably do better than what they had expected because they make the adjustment.
Agreed.
And nothing ever changes in this business, in any commission sale business. It's an 80-20, I feel like a 90-10 rule. Anyway, 10-15% of the people really get it and work on, everyone else is just sort of playing around and not really serious about it. And some of that's okay. Some people get a license to be a hobbyist or part-time or whatever. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if you seriously want to make this a career, create an exit strategy, then you have to adapt.
Right.
And it's time to reboot. So notes over in the show notes today for episode 122. And next week, we'll talk about a little bit deeper dive into some things, some gems I got from Inman Connect.
Good stuff. Watch this space.
You're listening to the Wandering But Not Lost podcast, where real estate and reality meet. Join us and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google Play, and now on YouTube.
Well, that's a wrap for the episode 122 of the Wandering But Not Lost podcast, where real estate and reality meet. All of our show notes over at WBNLpodcast.com. You know, Jen O'Brien, it was funny. I was thinking about when you were talking about how we had such a big push at the end of last year going into 2020 about creating your 2020 vision and how important it was to have your 2020 vision. And, you know, because 2020 vision is clarity and, you know, but really it was business planning, right? And, you know, you always had to drag people along kicking and screaming to do business planning. But everything that has happened this year between the COVID situation, the protest that's going on, the protests across the country that are going right now. I think everyone has been, in some way, shape, or form, been forced to take an introspective look at their clarity and get our vision and get some clarity about what they're going to do going forward. So I think it's kind of interesting that all this is happening in 2020, because I think this is the year of clarity for many, many people. So it's fascinating.
You know what, honestly, there it is. And that's the best way to just say what we talked about, is it's your opportunity to get clear about what's important to you, and then what adjustments, if any, you need to make to reach that, you know, to get to that place if you're not there yet, right?
So for sure.
I'm happy about that, and have a continued, you know, as excellent Florida experience as you can have, my friend, and we'll talk next week.
Very good. And remember, everyone, be safe out there. Be considerate, be kind, respect others. Boy, this just gets longer and longer, these PSAs. But the most important thing, be forever wandering, but not lost.